from God we receive. Bright light, we open up our eyes to see the majesty and glory of the King. He has filled our hearts with wonder so that we always
word
my hope secures. He wears my shield and bore me as long as life endures. My chains are.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to church this morning. It's good to see our church building filling up a little bit more every Sunday, and we're just so excited to see all of the Wesselson family here. Welcome. It's a special day as you bring Emily, little Emily, to the baptism font, and we're just really privileged and thankful that we can join you in this wonderful occasion. It's so good to see everybody here, and whether you're watching on screen or listening to a CD or whether you're here in person, we are here because God has called us to be here to worship, and we're excited to do that. My glasses are really fogging up. So it is our blessing to be together as church family, and as we go into this week, we can do that strengthened by God's love as He surrounds us and He fills us. I have no announcements, so I'm going to pass it on to the praise team, I believe.
Could you rise in body or in spirit? Come with your questions, come with your awe. For the God who broods over the chaos meets us in this place. Come with your energy, come with your weariness. For the God who breathes new life into the dust meets us in this place. Come with your sadness, come with your joy. For the God who dared to become human meets us in this place.
I do. Good morning. Receive God's greeting this morning. Mercy, peace, and love be yours in abundance. And all God's people say, amen. You may be seated. Brothers and sisters in Christ, the sacrament of baptism reminds and assures us that we share in the death and the resurrection of Christ and are incorporated into Christ's church. Baptism proclaims the faith of the church. The water of baptism is a sign and seal of God's promise to cleanse us from sin, to renew us, and to reconcile all things to himself in Christ. In baptism, God's people are promised the gift of the Holy Spirit as a pledge of this reconciliation. The same Spirit binds us to each other and joins us to Christ's ministry of love and of peace and of justice. Hear also these words from Scripture. All of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death. We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. Baptism is the sign and seal of God's promises to his covenant people. In baptism, God promises by grace alone to forgive our sins, to adopt us into the body of Christ, the church, and to send the Holy Spirit daily to renew us and to cleanse us, and to resurrect us to eternal life. The promises are made visible in the waters of baptism. Water cleanses, water purifies, water refreshes, water sustains. Jesus Christ is the living water. Through baptism, Christ calls us to a new obedience, to love and trust God completely, to forsake the evil in the world, and to live a new and holy life. Yet when we fall into sin, we must not despair of God's mercy, nor continue in sin, for baptism is the sign and the seal of God's eternal covenant of grace with us. Ryan and Erica, since you have presented Emily for holy baptism, I'll ask you to stand before God's people. Beloved of God, I ask you before God and Christ's church to reject evil, to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, and to confess the faith of the church. Do you renounce sin and the power of evil in your life and in the world? Who is your Lord and Savior? Do you believe that your children, though sinful by nature, are received of God by God in Christ as members of his covenant and therefore ought to be baptized? And do you promise, in reliance with the Holy Spirit and with the help of this Christian community, to do all in your power to instruct your children in the Christian faith and to lead them by your example into the life of Christian discipleship? What is your answer? Awesome. Brothers and sisters in Christ, I'll ask you to stand in body or in spirit. Do you promise to love and to encourage and to support Emily by teaching her the gospel of God's love, by being an example of Christian faith and character, and by giving the strong support of God's family in fellowship and in prayer and in service? What is your answer? We do, God helping us. Let us join with the whole baptized church of God in professing the faith that the church shares in renewing our baptismal covenants. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. Third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
I'd like to lead you in the prayer of thanksgiving. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the wonder of children and the gift of new life. We give thanks for Emily, who you love and sustain with your all-powerful hand. As Jesus knew love and discipline within a human family, may Emily grow in strength and wisdom. As Mary knew the joys and pains of motherhood, give Ryan and Erica your sustaining grace and love. May Emily know your love, your wisdom, and your care. May she grow up to live a life which glorifies you and brings blessings to others. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. You guys can come forward. Jackson, February the 16th of last year, you were here. You remember that? Today, Emily's turn. Emily, for you, Jesus came into this world. For you, he died and conquered death. All this he did for you, little one, though you know nothing of it yet. We love because God first loved us. She woke up. Emily, Rose Wesselson, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and to be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you his peace. Just like your daddy turned his face toward you and you had a big smile, right? And all God's people say? Amen. Beautiful. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the only King and head of the church, Emily is now received into the membership of the Holy Universal Christian Church, engaged to confess Christ and to be God's faithful servant until life's end. Let's give God some glory.
Ryan and Erica, on behalf of Covenant Christian Orange Church, your church, I have the privilege to give you two gifts. First is a certificate of baptism for Emily, and the second is the Jesus Storybook Bible. Yes, because you promised to raise Emily and, of course, Jackson in the way of the Lord, we hope you use it often, and don't be afraid to wear it out. I know it's been many years since I've told Ryan that he can wear out whatever, and I'll replace it, and then I promise to replace it if you ever do wear it out. So congratulations.
Thank you. You guys may be seated.
Could you rise in body and spirit and sing with us?
Boys and girls, hopefully someday soon we can be up together here at the front. But for now, I just want to share with you this. Remember, I asked Jackson if he remembered his baptism. He was just a little guy, I think only a few months old. And of course, he doesn't remember that. But whenever we have a baptism like this, it gives us all a chance to remember, whether we're little kids or big kids, to remember our baptisms and the promises that were made there, and also the commitment that we promise to love God in return. Let's go to our God in prayer. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. As your kingdom priests, we offer up prayers of intercession. Lord God, we pray along with Bill and Kobe and the Hannenberg family for Mike as he nears the end of his earthly journey apart from a miracle. So, Lord, we boldly go before you, the miracle maker, and ask for an extension on Mike's life. Lord, be merciful to him and to Catherine as they go through this trial together. Give them the peace that passes all understanding, the powerful working of your Holy Spirit, that they may experience you in a wonderful new way. Lord, we lift up intercessory prayers for all of our loved ones who have either wandered away from the faith and the communion of the saints, or who have yet to experience the bond of peace through the Holy Spirit. Hear our prayers, Lord, and turn hearts back to you. Turn the hearts of millions and billions to you before you come again to reign in glory and beauty and majesty and power. Heavenly Father, as we reflect today on your great emancipation of your people out of slavery in Egypt, it's horrible to think that we have to have an Emancipation Day here in Canada with the abolishment of the wicked institution of slavery in the British colonies, including Canada. Lord, help us to truly treat all people as equals, as worthy image bearers of you. And help us, your people, to speak out whenever inequality rears its ugly head. Oh Lord, we bless you for our creation, our preservation, and all the blessings of this life. But above all, for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, our brother, our high priest, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts, we may show forth your praise, pointing to your glory, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service, and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all of our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all the ages. And all God's children said, Amen.
I'll be reading Exodus 14. Then the Lord said to Moses, tell the Israelites to turn back and encamp at Phil-Harath between Migdal and the sea. They are to encamp by the sea directly opposite Baal Zephon. Pharaoh will think the Israelites are wandering around the land in confusion, hemmed in by the desert. I will harden Pharaoh's heart and he will pursue them. But I will gain glory for myself through Pharaoh and his army, and the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord. So the Israelites did this. When the king of Egypt was told that the people had fled, Pharaoh and his officials changed their minds about them and said, what have we done? We have let the Israelites go and have lost their services. So he had his chariot made ready and took his army with him. He took 600 of his best chariots, along with all the other chariots of Egypt, with officers over all of them. The Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, so that he pursued the Israelites, who were marching out boldly. The Egyptians, all Pharaoh's horses and chariots, horsemen and troops, pursued the Israelites and overtook them as they camped by the sea near Phil-Hahiroth, opposite Baal Zephon. As the Pharaoh approached, the Israelites looked up, and there were the Egyptians marching after them. They were terrified, and they cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, was it because there was no graves in Egypt that you brought us out to the desert to die? What have you done to us by bringing us out of Egypt? Didn't we say to you in Egypt, leave us alone? Let us serve the Egyptians. It would have been better for us to have served the Egyptians than to die in the desert. Moses answered the people, do not be afraid. Stand firm and you will see the deliverance the Lord will bring you today. The Egyptians will see you today and you will never see again. The Lord will fight for you. You need only be still. Then the Lord said to Moses, why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites to move on. Raise your staff and stretch your hand over the sea to divide the water so that the Israelites can go through the sea on dry ground. I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so that they will go after them, and I will gain glory through Pharaoh and his army, through his chariots and his horsemen. The Egyptians will know that I am the Lord when I gain glory through Pharaoh and his chariots and his horsemen. Then the angel of the Lord, who had been traveling in front of the Israelites' army, withdrew and went behind them. The pillar of cloud also moved from in front and stood behind them, coming between the armies of Egypt and Israel. Through the night, the cloud brought darkness to one side and light to the other side, so neither went near each other all night long. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and all that night the Lord drove the sea back with a strong east wind and turned it into dry land. The waters were divided. And the Israelites went through the sea on dry ground, with a wall of water on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued them, and all of Pharaoh's horses and chariots and horsemen followed them into the sea. During the last watch of the night, the Lord looked down from the pillar of fire and cloud at the Egyptian army and threw it into confusion. He jammed the wheels of the chariots so that they had difficulty driving. And the Egyptians said, "Let's get away from the Israelites. The Lord is fighting for them against Egypt." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea that the waters may flow back over the Egyptians and their chariots and horsemen." Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at daybreak, the sea went back to its place. The Egyptians were fleeing toward it, and the Lord swept them into the sea. The water flowed back and covered the chariots and horsemen and the entire army of Pharaoh that had followed the Israelites into the sea, and not one of them survived. But the Israelites went through the sea on dry ground, and with a wall of water on their right and on their left. That day the Lord saved the Israelites from the hands of the Egyptians and Israel. The Israelites saw the Egyptians lying dead on the shore. And when the Israelites saw the mighty hand the Lord displayed against the Egyptians, the people feared the Lord and put their trust in him and in Moses and his servant. This is the word of the Lord.
Brothers and sisters, some of us in our household just started watching the latest installment of the reality TV show, Big Brother. One of this year's contestants could certainly be described as being full of himself. Now, most people can't stand individuals full of vain glory. And if we're completely honest, we cringe a little with scripture texts like this one, which is all about glory, God's glory. Now, it's not cringy for us to hear about God's glory, but we wonder why God is promoting his own glory so hard. Is God so vain that he thinks the world revolves around him? Well, vanity, brothers and sisters, is having or showing an excessively high opinion of one's appearance, abilities, or worth. So with that definition, God is most definitely not vain. When his beauty is beyond compare, God is not vain when his abilities include things like omnipresence. He is always present. Omniscience, he is all-knowing. He's almighty, completely wise, just, and good. In fact, he is the overflowing source of all good, as our Belgic confession reminds us. And when it comes to worthiness, we have this from the 24 elders around his throne. "You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being." So in God's case alone, he is full of himself. But he can't get any fuller. And he can't get any less. His glory has always been with him. He can't get any more beautiful or intelligent or powerful. He already knows everything, sees everything, and is in charge of everything. So then God promoting his own glory isn't only for his own benefit, is it? It must be for ours. His chosen covenant people. His elect from the foundations of the world. His church, the bride of God's own dear Son. So as we study this scripture today, let's remember that if God wasn't supremely interested in making himself known and revealing his own glory, we would simply never see it. If God didn't toot his own horn, we would never hear him. And if God didn't make himself known, we would never know him. And not only that, God knows that when we exchange the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like mortal human beings and birds and animals and reptiles, that will hurt our hearts. When we give glory to created things instead of the creator of all things, it will result in our hearts getting hard and heavy. Worshipping the creation and making up all sorts of gods was a big part of Egyptian culture in the time of our text. But like all false religion, there are some elements of truth, similarities even with the great and supreme true religion. Take, for example, this slide you see on the screen. This Egyptian hieroglyphic depicts the judgment scene of the dead in the hall of Maat, the Egyptian goddess of order, harmony, and justice. Now, if you look, it's hard to see, but if you look at the center of that hieroglyphic, what's happening is that a person who has just died is going into the hall of Maat to have their heart weighed on a scale. If their heart is as light as a feather and nearly weightlessness, that indicated that the deceased soul was not burdened with sin and evil. And they could go on and live in the land of reeds with King Osiris. The land of reeds would be like our new creation. Now, if the heart was heavier than a feather, then the demon god Amut would eat your heart, and you would be sent to hell, a lake of fire. Interesting, eh? Okay, so with this bit of knowledge, if you were an Egyptian in those days, you would certainly hope that your great high priest, the mighty Pharaoh, the mediator between you and the gods, has a light heart, a soft heart, free from sin, right? Because if Pharaoh can't even get into eternal life, what chance have you got? And so far, after 10 rounds with Israel's God, it ain't looking very good for Pharaoh. Look at Exodus 10, 16 and 17, after the plague of the locusts. Pharaoh quickly summoned Moses and Aaron and said, "I have sinned against the Lord your God and against you. Now forgive my sin once more and pray to the Lord your God to take this deadly plague away from me." That confession of sin, brothers and sisters, and that prayer by Pharaoh for forgiveness is awesome. God answers those prayers. But if Pharaoh wants his heart to be as light as a feather to gain eternal life, there's only one way for that to happen. And that's a total circumcision of the hard heart of his. Pharaoh, who is full of himself, will have to die to self. And the only way to do that is to surrender to Israel's king. Know, acknowledge, and bow down in worship to the Lord God Almighty, the one who will not give his glory to idols. But Pharaoh will not surrender. He will keep getting up from that boxing ring mat, demanding another round with God. But after the 10th round and the death of the firstborn, it seems as though Pharaoh might be ready to surrender. Up, leave my people, you and the Israelites. Go and worship the Lord as you have requested. Sadly, this change of heart for Pharaoh didn't last long. And the old heart reared its ugly head. Exodus 14, verse 5, when the king of Egypt was told that the people had fled, Pharaoh and his officials changed their minds about them and said, "What have we done? We have let the Israelites go and have lost their services." They changed their minds. It reminds me of the Greek word metanoia. It's used to describe repentance. Well, this change of mind was an act of unrepentance. It was a change of heart away from God, not toward him. Brothers and sisters, in this whole Exodus account where Pharaoh attempts to fight the Lord God Almighty, we have five occurrences where God hardens Pharaoh's heart, and five where the texts say Pharaoh hardens Pharaoh's heart. Now, we don't have time to get into the doctrine of divine election and reprobation today, but just think about this given Egyptian afterlife beliefs and our afterlife beliefs. When Pharaoh hardens his heart, what happens to it? It gets heavy, right? Pharaoh, the great high priest, isn't going to pass over into eternal life, is he? Because his heart is going to be way heavier than a feather. So when Pharaoh hardens his own heart, he is basically saying, "I don't care if I go to hell, I won't let these people go. I will not surrender to Israel's God, ever. My glory is way too important." Now, that statement is something that God can agree with about himself. Do you know what the Hebrew word for glory is? It's kavod, and it means heavy. God's glory is heavy. It is of the utmost importance. That's why God keeps repeating it in our text. Look at verse 4. "And I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and he will pursue them, but I will gain glory for myself through Pharaoh and his army, and the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord." People of God, sometimes we don't like to dwell on it, but God gains glory for himself through judgment. And the one true God will judge us if we serve a bunch of false God's. And maybe we think we can't relate to these little statue kinds of gods that the Egyptians served. But gods can come in many shapes and sizes, can't they? The gods of power and pleasure, of control and safety, of health and wealth are alive and well today. And just like Pharaoh, we often worship at the altar of our own pride and ego. This often takes the form of obsession with careers and jobs. But the question we need to ask ourselves is this: where will the glory of that God take us? Whatever God or gods we are serving instead of or alongside of our true God, where are those gods taking us? And what are they doing to our hearts? Are they taking us to the promised land? Or will they lead us into a watery grave? When Deb and I went on our trip to Egypt, we saw some ancient Egyptian temples. And I was a little surprised to see how similar they were to the Jewish temple, to our temple. They had an outer court, a middle priestly court, and an inner sanctuary, like the temple's most holy place. It was there that the local god's image would be placed. Now, the goal for the Egyptian person was to go through the outer court and, with the help of the Pharaoh, the high priest, one day to make it to the most inner sanctuary, to spend an eternity with the God, with whatever God that was, in the field of reeds. Given this understanding, here's something you might find interesting. In the priest court of many of these ancient Egyptian temples, we saw these huge columns intentionally shaped and fashioned like a lotus flower, a blue water lily. The lotus flower holds a significant place in Egyptian mythology and is regarded as a symbol of the sun and a sign of rebirth. The lotus closes at night and sinks underwater. In the morning, it reemerges and blooms again, part of God's wonderful creation. But the Egyptians saw that the blue water lotus opened up each morning, seeing the intense golden center set out against those beautiful blue petals. They saw an imitation of the golden sun appearing in the big blue sky. Thus, the flower became a natural symbol of the sun god, Ra. Now, to the Egyptians, the Sea of Reeds is where Ra, the sun god, does battle with some sea monster every night so that the people of Egypt can have life and order. Our text today is all about the Red Sea, Yam Suf in the Hebrew. Well, guess what a literal translation of Yam Suf is? It is the Sea of Reeds. Isn't that interesting? Because Pharaoh and the high priest of his people will go through the Sea of Reeds, the Red Sea this time, and he will attempt to deliver his people through the Sea of Reeds and ultimately to the holy place, the field of reeds. That's the imagery we see played out in this text. But what happens when Pharaoh tries to follow God's people through the sea of reeds? The one true God swallows them up. They're mighty chariots, useless against God. Pharaoh, the great high priest of Egypt, can't even get his army through the priest court, let alone the Holy of Holies. Pharaoh's people all drown in the sea of reeds. A hard-hearted Pharaoh sank his people. He led them to a watery grave, and so will all our false idols. That happened, everyone, because Pharaoh is no great high priest. Jesus Christ, on the other hand, the Son of the living God, is the great high priest. A high priest who is not half human and half God, like the Egyptians believed the Pharaohs to be. Jesus Christ was fully God and fully human. The mystery of the two natures of Christ. And his heart was as light as a feather. Not a sin within him. And what did Jesus do with that sinless record of his? Jesus took it not into the halls of Ma'at, some false god. Jesus took it straight into the Holy of Holies, where the throne of God is. And Jesus splashed his own atoning blood all over the judgment seat, turning it into the mercy seat. Jesus did that by dying on a cross in our place, where God poured out his wrath against all of our hard-hearted sins, so that we could follow Jesus from the wilderness, the outer courts, into the holy place, and straight into the throne room of God. And it is there where our adoption becomes official. It is here that we are adopted into God's forever family through faith in Jesus Christ, his Son, our brother and great high priest. That's the good news. God's glory is not only revealed through judgment, it is revealed through salvation. It is revealed through grace, a glorious, amazing kind of grace. But it doesn't mean that everyone is saved. So the question we should have is this: will God be glorified in our judgment, like hard-hearted Pharaoh, or in our salvation through faith in light-hearted Jesus? If anyone wants salvation, we have to be moved forward like the Israelites. Away from Egypt, away from the bondage of sin and idolatry, and into the sea of reeds. Like the Egyptian lotus flower, and like our sacrament of holy baptism, we see vivid imagery of dying and rising again, don't we? We see the path that God has prepared to allow us to cross over the sea onto dry ground, which is the picture of entering eternal life into the promised land, the new creation, the new heavens, and the new earth. But it's interesting to note how we cross over. We cross over by drowning, don't we? We die to self. And we trust that God's glory will result in our greatest good. That's how we're born again. And that is a gracious work of God's Holy Spirit, the same Spirit who hovered over the chaos at creation, turning the chaos into order. Ma'at didn't do that. The Holy Spirit did. The same Spirit who hovered over the sea of reeds, turning that chaos into dry ground. This same Holy Spirit meets us at the bottom of the sea of reeds and breathes new life into us. And this same Holy Spirit cuts out our hard hearts, our hard and heavy hearts, and gives us a heart as light as a feather. If you've never put your trust in Jesus, trust Him today. He'll be with you in the wilderness. He'll take you through the priest court, and He'll make sure that you enter the promised land to live with Him in glory forever and ever. And all God's people say, amen. Let's pray. Lord God and Heavenly Father, sometimes we get suspicious when we see the similarities between the false religions and the true religion of Christianity. Yet, Lord, the devil has been doing that from the very beginning. We see it in the garden, twisting your words here and there, keeping elements of truth, but twisting it in a horrible way. For, Lord, in the Egyptian mythology, a person had to do good and to be free from sin to enter eternal life. We are so thankful that's not the way it works. But we're thankful that our Lord Jesus, the sinless one, died on our behalf so that we could enter into the holy place. And we know where our destination is, even though we have to go through wilderness times here and now. We know our future is bright and our home is glorious. Lord, may we be strengthened by this hope of the bodily resurrection. May we be witnesses of the true gospel revealed to us in your holy and infallible word. We pray this in your precious name. Amen.
Would you rise with us in body and spirit? Thank you.
Our offerings this morning are for the work of the deacons and for our church ministries and budget. Let's go to our God in prayer. Lord God and Father, we are so thankful for our deacons and the work that they do on our behalf and in your name and for your glory. We pray a blessing upon them as they discern how best to be good stewards for us and to also teach us to speak out against the injustices not only in our community, but in this country and in this world. We pray that you would fill them with your Holy Spirit. Fill this church, Lord. We're so thankful we could gather freely and to worship you and to point to your glory. Lord, we give you thanks for all this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Where's Erica? Is she going to... Are you guys okay to possibly do... We're after the service, we'll ask Ryan and Erica to be in the back. We will respect their distance, but we can at least walk by and offer our congratulations to them. And yeah, if you guys want to do that after the service. All right, receive God's blessing. Go now to will and to work for God's purposes. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. Be filled with the same love and look to the interests of others. With reverence for God, work out your salvation. And may God quench your thirst with love and consolation. May Christ Jesus strengthen you and encourage you. And may the Holy Spirit lead you on and make your joy complete. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Jesus Christ, and all God's people say, Amen.